Inverse Phase, a chiptune artist, is actually one of my roommates, and he wanted to up his stage presence. And so instead of trying to figure out, okay, we can put lights on the outside or something like that, he bought these two panels for about $80 a piece off of eBay. They're a set of 16x16 WS2812s for a total of 512 lights just stuck to the back of his laptop, so he can bring his own light show anywhere that he's playing. One of the problems with this, though, is that not only do you have to figure out what to put on them, which he's going to have to figure out, but you're going to have to be able to control them. So rather than using any existing USB bridges like that and doing some research and trying to buy it and whatnot, I wanted a solution in, you know, an hour. And it wasn't that hard. I had this extra board right here that has a little AVR on it. It's an ATmega 32U2, which means it only has a kilobyte of RAM, 1.5 kilobytes of LEDs, 3 bytes for each LED, and 1 kilobyte of RAM. And the timing on these is very stringent. You can't just stop sending for a while and keep sending. So, in order to get the data from the laptop to this continuously, we got to do something a little bit tricky. When you're dealing with WS2812s, the easiest way to really send the data out is to use just some sort of really quick macro. And here, all we're really doing is just turning port D, pin 3, on and off at the right times to match the spec. There's a really neat website that I have in the description that goes through this in great detail, how to choose these times, but it's pretty straightforward. And then at the end of this, you get one function that you send an 8-bit value to, and it outputs the next 8-bit value to the 2812s. You need 3 of these per LED. When you're dealing with USB, I end up just using this thing I got off of a different site, which it's like the Teensy site, and I've been modding that for a very long time now. I don't use Lufa normally unless I have an overwhelming reason to do so. That way, this whole project here is 2 kilobytes instead of much larger. Additionally, I use control messages because they're generally easier to deal with, and I'm surprised, but you get better performance on most systems. So, one of the first things you do, and this is all inside of the USB COM interrupt vector, and you can see here that you have different requests and different request types. So A3, A4, A6, and the one we care about, A5. A5 here has that WS2812 code in it, and it computes the number of messages that will need to be received, each with length 64, and if there's any remaining bytes after that. So we go and we loop through all of the messages. So if we have, say, 256 bytes we're sending out, it'll loop through this 4 times. And the very first thing we do whenever we need to read data off of the USB part of the AVR is read from UEDATX. This is a lot better than trying to write some function and then read the function and copy the stuff to the buffer, because this instruction right here takes only about 2 cycles to execute, which is really convenient. We can read that into the buffer, and we can send out to the WS2812s that first byte. Then, byte after byte after byte after byte, we can keep reading the data in from the USB. Then we can send out the next WS2812. By doing this, we can actually kind of front-load our work, or back-load our work, in order to be able to read all the data from the USB while sending to the WS2812s. But you might ask, well, why not just say send WSUEDATX? That's because when you're sending all of this data, you can only do so in groups of 64 before you send an ACK out. This ACK out here takes a little bit of time before you can actually go keep reading more data. So we send the ACK out, and then we keep reading a bunch of WS2812s. In fact, sending a bunch of WS2812s. In fact, we have to send the remainder of all the WS2812s. Then, this takes a fairly long period of time, and we can call this function here, wait receive out. This generally does not block because we're still sending WS2812 data while the data is being streamed to the AVR. So, by doing this sort of funny dance with pipelining, which you can do in code in all sorts of applications, you're able to do things that may otherwise seem impossible. So I hope this is a useful tool for you guys to be able to go use and apply to different and new interesting projects.